What's up, everybody? I'm Pat Petrillo, and I want to welcome you to the first in maybe a couple series talking about the Bridgeman Drumline legacy. And we're starting with the year of 1982 because 1982 was a really special year in many ways, and it was the third of three straight championships, but we were very fortunate to get a lot of people in here together to talk about specifically the 82 season, a bunch of things about it, the One Tick Show, so many things that we're going to discuss. And we have some questions that have been thrown at us by a few other people as well in various forums. And but first of all, I want to thank all my brothers for being here. And I want to kick it over to the man himself, Mr. Dennis DeLucia, who's going to get us started and be our moderator and just kind of get things going. So Dennis, take it away.
Thanks, Pat and Jim. Thank you both for setting this up and making this happen. And it's so great to see everybody. Lead us to 82 very briefly without any lectures or I'm just curious. So where did 82 come from in terms of the talent?
I think the nucleus, well, we had six, we had, I was talking to Jim about this today. We had, and I was at college, so I was coming back and forth to rehearsals. And every time I came, there seemed like it was a crop of new people auditioning. And we had six snares that came back from the previous year. So we did have a six snare nucleus. And as far as that goes, and, you know, we had like, how many people auditioned, Jim, for two snare spots?
Well, we were talking about it today. I remember showing up to the first rehearsal and there were 90 people auditioning for snare drum and there were six people returning and I think we were going to go with 10. So it was nine, you know, somewhere around 80, 90 people for four spots.
Wow.
And Doobie cut 85 of them on the first rehearsal. Get out of here.
Bob, do you have any recollection of some of the winter stuff at all?
82?
Yeah.
Doobie.
No, where were we rehearsing? We were rehearsing in, we were at St. Andrews and Maris High School. Is that where we started those rehearsals?
That was Bayonne High School.
Bayonne High School.
Yeah, I remember going to Jersey City State.
Yeah, that's what I remember.
I just don't.
A lot of it was at the high school.
Yeah. I just remember sitting with Dennis, you know, because we brought the kids in one at a time.
Yeah.
And after number 45, you know, your head starts spinning, your eyes glaze over. Because most of them are, I mean, I found this in my career. I'm sure you guys have too. Most of them are just really not ready for that level. I mean, they were the main leader in their snare line in high school. And they thought, hey, I can go drum with the Bridgeman and try this thing out. And they just, you know, we knew in the first rudiment that it wasn't going to happen. But, you know, we didn't want to be, you know, next. So we heard them out. We listened to them play. We took our time with them. We asked them questions. You know, Dennis was always great with, you know, finding out about their background. Would they be interested in doing anything else if they didn't make snare? Remember the index cards Dennis used to pass out?
Of course.
The name, what you wanted to play, what's the second thing you want to play, what's the third thing you want to play, your experience, all that stuff really helped. But it was, you know, he just really wanted to get to know the person more than just the hands. That was a little not so cool for me. So I was just like, this kid ain't going to make it next. we got 43 other guys to go then. Come on.
Hey, Doobie, I think I was one of the guys you cut on that first round.
Interesting story about that. And Bob is right. I mean, I was coming in and out and I remember that, and you're talking about how did everybody get here? And Mark is a perfect example of how we started to get a little bit more from people from all around. But I would be remiss if I didn't mention Mike Page.
Absolutely.
Who came from the Blue Devils. And I was there with his first rehearsal and it was very eye-opening experience. And he was a great guy, rest in peace. It was an amazing guy. And it was very eye-opening for him to be like, oh, do you guys play this faster? Yeah, we do. So Mike and then Jeff McKay, who came from Canada. And then Todd Suhu also. came from Devils, right, Todd?
That's right.
And mallet player, and then Mark Purdom. And Mark Purdom, you know, I was the guy that was always bringing somebody from Kentucky every year. 81, I brought up a tenor player,
Greg Strauss. Not
my buddy Greg Strauss. And then 82, I brought up Mike DeLong and Mark Purdom. And Mark's sought me out when he were going to UK, right, Mark?
Yeah,
and,
absolutely.
And he sought me out at Moorhead, and we would get together and ram on the boards at Moorhead.
Yeah.
And we just would ram and ram, and it's like, oh, man, this is, I don't know if I can make it. And the perseverance that you had. And then when it came to that point, and we had a conversation with Dennis, like, well, listen, man, you know, he's right on the cusp. I say, I'll work his ass off. That's all it is. I'll just work his ass off. And if, you know, you were so cool about it, and whatever happened, you, whatever hook or crook, you can get up there, bro. You did it. So props to you, to Mark, for sure.
Yep.
What are your recollections?
Talking about that was, you know, the high school line and the college line and all that, and go, wow, it'd be really cool to play in Bridgman. And then, you know, I got with Pat and I'm like, holy shit. You know, I can't play the warm-up exercises. Let me see if I can figure this out, you know. So it took a while.
Matt?
Well, really, I lived in Syracuse, New York. I guess if money were no object, I guess I would go to California and march in Santa Clara. But marching in the Bridgman was a dream, literally a dream. I used to play the 1980 record in my college dorm room every single day. And my like other hallmates hated me because I just wanted to play In the Stone. And so 1981 had the opportunity. So
let's get into 82 in particular. One of the topics, going from 9 snares to 8. What was that like?
Yeah, Matt, what was it like when we cut you? Oh, wait a minute.
Close.
Ouch.
Well, I mean, everybody knows why that happened, right? You know, poor Mike, first tour, got really sick, and he missed. You guys remember, like, it was like a whole week, I think.
Yeah.
He was just out. He just couldn't get off his sleeping bag.
Right.
And, you know, because of the talent we had in the line, we improved quick. I mean, it didn't take long for the staff to get the guys in the line to do what we were asking them to do. They all had the expectation. They all, you know, like you said, 6 out of the 8 snares were there from 81. And, you know, they knew how we did things and they knew how intense the rehearsals were. And we just got so good so quick in the week that he was out. When he tried to hop back in, I'll never forget, we were in, I think we were at Rutgers. Rodney was judging. And he came up to us at the end of the, I think we lost to the Crossmen that day in Ticks. Is that right?
What it was, Doobie, this was even before Mike tried to come back in. There was a gentleman on the end of the line next to Matt, which is why I said that. Matt knows where I'm going with this. We were losing to the Crossmen pretty much
every week,
right, Jay? We were getting them boys were clean as snot. And so you at the Dream Contest had Rodney Key where the Ticks were.
Mm.
And it happened to be the one gentleman on Matt's side of the line over there.
Tight end. Yeah.
Yeah. And so Matt, maybe you could speak to that a little bit more. I mean, you heard where it was coming from. I mean, and what happened. So
yeah, that was difficult because, you know, he was working hard. And it was me and Mark Tiafolo on that end and Jeff McKay. And we heard it all the time. And, you know, it was just unfortunate. And I was relieved when that decision was made, you know, when we
that
went
was
from,
huge.
From 10
I mean, that
to
was
9.
That was right before we were going on second tour. It was right after the Dream Contest.
Right. Yeah. He never came back for second tour.
No, right. Because we cut him. Right,
not on snare, but he was in the pit, right?
No, we're not talking about Mike Page.
Oh, not Mike Page. We're talking
the kid with the hair.
So
he was from. I don't know if you remember this, Doobie, but I remember. I think it was Matt and I. We cornered you one night, and we're like, "Dude, we're tired of getting beat like this, and we're not working hard enough. We got too many leakers. Let's get after it." And it was soon after all that happened that we just came right together. Yep. And it was quick, like you said. It was super quick.
It literally was overnight. I mean, it was literally, and it was just, you know, to the point that I think, Jay, you probably could agree that it wasn't as clean as we knew it could have been. And maybe we just, maybe we're resting on our laurels a little bit. I don't know.
We were getting old and fat. Jay's fat, ready front.
But I think, you know what? But that friendly seeing Crossman every freaking week and getting beat, you know, Robbie and them. Yeah, man. And that's a motivating factor right there.
Hey, Matt, you remember getting frustrated with me because I kept looking down your side of the line? You said, stop looking down here.
Teofilo would get so pissed about that. Oh, man.
Yeah.
You know, I tell the story. When I would see a judge, and I'm being truthful, when I saw a judge going to the opposite side of the snare line, I'd be like, uh-oh, come back down to our side. Come back down to our side, because I know our side is rock solid. So all this, you know, right side of the line sucks or whatever like that. I just laughed. Mark and I just laughed, and Al, right?
You know, those eight snares didn't show up out of thin air. It was, and I think one of the reasons that the line got to be so good so quickly was that, as Doobie said, everybody knew what to expect, and there were certain criteria, and there were expectations that had to be met. As simple as that.
I think one thing, I've been thinking about this when we got this email, because I can't remember hardly anything. I need you guys to tell me what I remember, but 1980 was really important for 1982. And that week we spent in Salem, Massachusetts, was the hardest week of my life, but I think it changed the way I thought about things. And then the 81 line, the way that line was, you know, with Wayne and Moon and all those guys, that we just got to a point where we learned how to do things. So then when those in 82, when we were struggling at the beginning, it was like, what's going on with this? And I think that all those lessons that the core group of that 82 group knew how to play clean, knew how hard we were supposed to work, knew how hard we were supposed to practice. And it took a long time to get there. I mean, I know myself, I had such a bad year in 81 that I had to go through that so I could get to where I was in 82, mentally, emotionally, you know. And I think with the core group we have, with Pat and Matt and Tio and, you know, and thinking about like a kid like Tommy Igo ticking his ass off on the end of the line early and then becoming incredibly great at the end. Just all the things, I think all 3 years it took to make the 82 line. And that last 2 weeks, obviously, were incredibly special.
Yeah, that's spot on, bro. And it's very different now, like it was. I mean, now kids, you know, spend 1 or 2 years and are somewhere else or that's it. But it was a nucleus then, for sure. It did get molded.
Well, one thing about me, I love stability, and we were stable. Mm-hmm. And Doobie coming up in that line from 79 to 80 to 81 to 82, I just kind of grew. And I had an attitude as, you know what, I don't care. Let's play. Whatever it takes to win, let's do it. Mm-hmm. And everyone had that same mindset.
Mm-hmm. Now, Al, you were not a great reader, if I remember right. Is that correct?
Reader? No, no, I was not. I was not. Coming from a... the Richmond in Brooklyn, we did not read.
Right. So now, did your playing grow? You went for 3 years, right?
No, five. 79.
You were in for 5 years. Okay. So did your skills improve? I mean, were you able to read by the end?
By the end, I was reading, yes.
Yeah.
Because I don't think I would have survived if I had.
Yeah.
And with the help of you, Pat, Bobby, oh, man, Dennis, you, and you guys just kind of facilitated that. I'm like, it was ridiculous. The steps that I took to come through it. And yeah. You know what? What's so funny is I have roll calls now since I've retired, and those same things that we went through then, I still use today.
Hey, you know, to that point, you know, we all, I think, on the East Coast, and this is for everybody who's watching this now on whatever it may be on, you know, none of us read, really. I mean, I was in drum corps since I was 13, and we all learned by rote, right? That was how we all learned, and we grew up playing by rote. None of us could really read. Dennis would write the stuff out, and I know that half, you know, Dube, you were teaching by rote a lot. You were teaching us in four-bar chunks, three-bar, you know, put the chunks together. You know, none of us could really read. And then, you know, it's interesting because we all, I think, started to, you know, come in at the same time. We started to get guys who were like myself and Mark and Matt, guys who were going into college for music. And we were starting to get better at reading and stuff. And, you know, things started to get better. And I started putting things together a lot better. But I couldn't read for the longest either, for sure.
The benefits were different than just being able to play now.
Yeah. Well, yeah. My biggest thing is, and I still to this day, I learned how to be great at something. That's the biggest thing, and I've carried that along into my career, my teaching. You know, I was just happy-go-lucky kid from Florida, really laid back, and I didn't. It opened the inner beast. The inner beast that sometimes needs to be tamed still to this day. But, you know, more than the drumming, it was the championship part, the behavior, the inside. And I'm very fortunate I've been able to pass that lesson on to a lot of people.
That's awesome.
As well.
Well, everybody who watched in the line in Doobie's years there learned a lot from Bob Dubinsky.
Yeah.
And didn't necessarily have to do with X's and O's. It had to do with being.
Hard. I still give the man in the glass to my students every year.
Same here.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes.
Every year. We have one night towards the end where we sit down and do it. And I still recite, I remember, because that was my only year marching in the Corps. And I still recite the not just the poem, but the description of the poem that Bob did. And the way he did it and the way he delivered it, the heartaches and tears. Heartaches and tears, people. And it was an amazing impression it made on this 21-year-old. And I tried to pass that on to all of my kiddos, you know.
Yeah, Bob, man, if it wasn't for you, we wouldn't have won. Not one or two, definitely not three. So
it wasn't just the clean playing, clean, and the expressive playing, which that's a whole nother thing, but it was the heart. And that's what Bob brought to
the wall, baby.
The wall. I give that one still to this day, too.
Absolutely. Hey, I got a quick question for Todd. So what was your impression like when you came out here from the West Coast and you're in a great, you know, organization, you know, from the Blue Devils, you know, not just, you know, being in finals all the time and just being always up there, but the organization itself, the way it's run and all that. And coming to the Bridgman was a bit different. And, yeah. You know, just kind of like how we rolled and then, you know, sadly how our organization, you know, started to turn left. But I mean, what was your impression when you came out?
So, you know, I got my impression in 81. We were doing a show together and, you know, we do those. Sometimes you do the retreat and you do the single file, the whole corps, and we're next to the other guys in the other corps. So we're all lined up. And the mallet section beat from BD was side by side with the Bridgman. So I was hanging out with Pat and Eddie and the guys, and you know, the people just really grabbed me, and you know, it, and everyone's so real. So, you know, that was very different. I had a real culture shock, you know, where I came from, it was very tiered. I was kind of on the bottom of the ladder, and everyone, you know, the equality, you know, and everything, just everyone is just a person and everyone's cool. And it doesn't matter what you play. And that was really different. And, you know, and then the best, you know, line in the country on top of that, there's nowhere else to go. After I met the guys, and my mind was made up.
Was the rehearsal thing, how big of a difference, you know, the intensity of our rehearsal compared to what you were going through?
You know, it was at a totally different level. You know, Dennis and Doobie just run things in a way where you can go so much further. I mean, they work really hard where I came from, but it's sort of like just forcing, just try harder, do it again. And but it didn't have something else behind it that really was different. I think that's the
right
thing,
Matt.
Right.
Heart. It's that passion, man. It's that heart. It's that fire. It's all those things that Bob, you brought out in all of us, man. And
yeah, so. I think, I mean, oh, shucks. Thanks. I really appreciate all that stuff. That's great. But I think the difference between, like, we had nothing. I mean, if it wasn't for Dennis, you know, having ties to the companies that he had ties to, who knows what we would have been playing on. I mean, look at the brass. What they were, those poor kids had to play on. It was just like ridiculous. And nobody ever complained about it. Like when I was marching in the cadets, nobody ever thought twice about when Santa Clara came rolling in with the three beautiful painted Santa Clara Vanguard. We were riding around in like 1956 buses where you had to, you know, stick the drumstick in the window to keep it open to get some air conditioning. And that just carried through to the Bridgman on a greater expanse of poor. I mean, we had, you know, nothing. I mean, it was just like really ridiculous. But I don't remember any of you guys ever saying, "Oh man, look at the Blue Devils rolling in with all these trucks, and look at the what do they serve food out of that thing? Holy mackerel! Okay. It's bigger than our
Ooh,
equipment truck." Yeah, it was nuts. But, you know, the whole mindset of, you know, you guys never expected anything from anybody but yourselves. And, you know, from Dennis and myself and anybody else that was on the drum staff, you just wanted to play. And it didn't matter that you weren't getting enough nourishment. I mean, you know, you look like stick figures at the end of the season. And it was just like, well, whatever. But nobody ever said anything about it. It was just like, okay, strap it in, let's mm-hmm. go. So I admired you guys for that, because it was a different world. You know, Todd came from the Ritz-Carlton, you know, down to the Beachcomber Motel in Wildwood, and it was like,
gladly.
That's a great segue to how we got our drums in '82, and we started to get a little bit, you know, picky as to what color we wanted. Jen, talk about your switching to Slingerland, and how that thing went down, and the interesting drum choices you presented us with.
Well, we had been with Ludwig, you know, before that. And then Ward Durrett was working at the time for Slingerland. And I know most of you know who Ward is. Great, great guy. And he just fell in love with the Bridgman and what we were doing. And he came to me one day and said, "What do you think?" And it was at a time when we were looking for something different. We didn't want to be, you know, white with silver hardware like the rest of the world at the time. And Slingerland was nice enough to make four or five different prototypes, different finishes, you know, red with the white hardware and all these things, and brought them in, if you guys remember that. And we ended up choosing the black with gold because it went with our uniform the best. And it's the color scheme. I kind of liked it because I thought it was badass. Bobby liked it because it fit in with the color scheme. So, you know, we went with it, and it ended up being really good for us.
Yeah. Not only that, but we said we want black drums or go hardware, period. Right? Basically, we right? You guys remember? We get new drums. Black drums, go hardware. And then you open up a box and one was red with some white. I don't know what. One was, what was it green? I don't even know. And we were like, you're not even trying to bring that shit out on us. I'm telling you right now, that one better be black and gold.
Yeah, boom. But what you young men did not know at the time was that the decision had already been made.
I remember somebody saying that the red would have looked like ketchup on eggs. With the yellow coats.
Oh, gosh. Wow. So,
we were getting the black with gold, and anything else was for show. You know what I mean?
Well, that was a game changer. That was just a game changer for us. And then the other question that we get a lot is why slings? And, you know, we just, and I don't even know if you presented us with the harness thing in 82, but that was never going to happen neither. Because we're just like, this is how we do it. This is how we play. There's no way that we're switching to harnesses. Not going to happen.
And, in 82, we were asked about the harnesses.
We were asked about it, and we said no. And I remember Mark Tiafolo probably being the most vocal of anybody about it. But we just weren't comfortable. Matt, what'd you think?
I didn't want to switch. I love the sling. I love how it's close to my body. I love how when we moved, all the drums went together. Oh, that was
just... Yeah, man.
So
plus we didn't have to do no. Plus we didn't have to do no crazy drill.
Right.
I used to get asked that. I'm sorry, Al. I used to get asked that question a lot. You know, at clinics or whatever, or just hanging out with other people. So how come you guys are still using slings? And I needed a good bullshit story. So what I came up with was, we wanted the drum to sit close to the body and move because we wanted the drum to be. To become one with our being, and it's like, wow. Oh, really? Yeah, that was it.
I mean, he's partially right.
I know that. Partially right, for sure.
We just grew up playing that way and didn't want to change. End of story. And that's what made us unique, and that's why we never went to 14s. We stayed with 15s. Your sound, your writing, the way you wrote for that style of music, a 15 lent itself to that. And that was it.
You mentioned the writing, and I think it's worth commenting on the writing, you know, Dennis's writing in that particular style, which nobody pretty much has ever duplicated or even, you know, it's so different. But I think the big knock on us was always, oh, look how easy what they're doing is. Look how easy, because people didn't really understand the rudiments hidden inside the groove. The vocabulary that we had was as astounding compared to pretty much anybody else. And yet it was hidden inside a groove. And, you know, you displace one note and something, and it doesn't feel right anymore, you know? So, and that's not just because Dennis is on my payroll at Pinnell. I mean, it's just, you know, it always seems to make sense to me for that style of music to write that. I understand why people don't get that.
Go ahead, Bob.
I would argue that that's what eliminated a lot of people from the line. I think that that's what eliminated a lot of players. Being able to feel music. I mean, they could read it, they could play it, but just be able to lock it in the pocket. And, you know, when we would, you know, everybody's talked about how we hung rolls. Oh, you hung rolls. Well, you know, it was the backbeat of the time. And we were just listening, and the bass drum line's ability to kind of hear the roll between the snares and the quads, maybe not being up to the right tempo and being able to slow their 16th notes underneath it.
Incredible.
Yeah.
And actually, Jim, didn't we even say that today in our conversation?
Yeah.
The bass line, like, you know, we talk about the rim shot around the world. I guess we need to get into the book a little bit more, but...
A little hard to pick some of these things up in the audio, but
I the baseline on that long roll before shaft pop. And then you could tell the other story, Dan, that you told me, but the baseline just pulling that back and leading us just enough, you know, because we never obviously practiced with the tink, 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 you know, with no Met. It, you know, we were the Met, and, you know, it was breathing, and that's the way the line, it was like an amoeba, is the way I like to think of it. It was just a breathing, living thing that just kind of had a heartbeat. It wasn't metronomic time, and I tell this to my drum set students, it's not metronomic time, it's the groove around whatever perfect time is, and I think we all were sensitive to that. And I mean, Jay can attest to the fact how many times the tenors had to slow down for things for us, right? And put it in, you know, certain things.
That you could hear it coming, man. You just feel it. It's coming down the line. You find those ticks too, and whoop, off. Yeah. Here they come. But yeah, it was a breathing, living thing that doesn't exist today. Mm. You know, my kids can't understand that. You know, and the way the guys clean drum lines now, they do it all based on metronome.
Yeah.
All metronomic consistency. And I get that. But there's a point where, you know, here it comes, man. Can't you hear it coming? And get off of it. Don't make it. Don't make that mistake right there. And they can't, man. If it goes south, it's south forever.
Yeah. And I would give, you know, you, Jay, the credit for, I mean, we really didn't have, we kind of had a thin staff. And you were pretty much doing the tenors from inside. And I think that actually worked out to the benefit of the group, because you understood that and you were able to communicate that to the other players in the line, where I think somebody outside of the line might have tried to fight that a little bit, because they want, you know, take, this is my tenor line and my tenor line is going to do this and the snare line is going to do that, but I'm going to fight for my turf. And you, because you were in the line teaching, you kind of, am I making any sense here? It kind of made
perfect.
We were totally connected to the snare line. We were totally connected. It was an extension. And when the basses were on the other side, it was an extension of the whole line. It wasn't the snares, the tenors, the basses. It was the line.
And the writing, and the writing lent itself to that, and all the in-between stuff, you had to do that, or else it would have fell apart. And Jay, it was basically, essentially, you and Dave Kaminsky, and then you had three new players that year. In 82, didn't you? You didn't quite have the nucleus that the snare line had.
That's right. Mike DeLong, right out of the hills, didn't have shoes, from Kentucky. I mean, well, hay bale out of his mouth. Couldn't understand him. And I'm from the South. I couldn't understand him. Tommy Igo, a kid. I used to make him come and pick me up, and his dad bought him a new real nice car, custom. I used to make him come and pick me up.
And he played bass in 81, and he said he moved up to tenors in 82.
And I was it Greg Strauss? Was the was
no,
he
Greg
the
was in 81. The other guy was Sam Mankemiller.
Oh, yes. Sam. Oh, my goodness.
Virginia. How could you forget Sam?
I'm sure Sam has me blotched out of his memory.
Sam, if you're watching this, we love you, brother. We do. We really do. So you had, it was basically you and Dave Kaminsky, and then you had to break in three new guys.
Yeah, it was, the communication was so nonverbal, you know, there was so much just connection. We really connected. It took a while. I mean, I joined 82 late. I don't know if you guys remember that, but I my audition was like, all right, we're going to do a blind audition. You play shaft with, I think it was Greg Strauss then. And if you make a tick, you're out. So, and I was faking and guessing at all kinds of crap, but that's gotta be him. That's gotta be him. So I made it. And finally, I was the best thing I ever did. Best decision I ever made.
So Dennis, why don't we get into the solo, man, and talk about that, how you crafted it. Cause now we want to kind of get into the book a bit and talk about the solo, and then we have to eventually get into the one tick show and then move on to finals and prelims and then finals. But let's talk about Black Market Juggler, man.
Well, Doobie and I were big fans of Weather Report, at that time. And of course, we had just played Pursuit of the Lady with the Feathered Hat and developed a finger thumb thing for what, five bars in that. And I wanted to do something more with that technique. But in my mind, as a writer, it had to be more than just laying down 16th notes. So what can we do? Okay, Remo, we need to run a rototoms and we're going to try this. I'll be honest with you. I never thought the line could pull that off. Keeping the finger thumb 16ths going in unison and playing bum, bing, you know, the obligato parts. It's like, okay, this is nuts here that we're even going to try this.
Marching wise, the rest of the corps just having fun out there, but let's keep an eye on the snares here. They work rototoms on stands as well.
It's a remarkable achievement by that drum line. And Doobie, what am I leaving out? But I mean, we wanted to stay with Weather Report because we loved their music, and Black Market was a logical choice. Such a great groove.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know when we. I remember we did it in your apartment in Belleville.
Yeah.
And we came up with the introduction being from the Juggler.
Right.
Just to add that into the Retardando, into the groove, but again, I thought. You know, you thought that the Black Market thing could lend itself to a real good, you know, Bridgman kind of style groove, and obviously it did. So, yeah,
my question would be what I loved about the solo would be the way the thing starts with the, you know, the feel right out of the gate was very un-Bridgman like.
Right,
this really aggressive. And then to settle down was the great thing. But so was the Juggler when did that come into, we need to, you know, start with this and then get into the groove? How did that transpire?
Well, I didn't want to start with the bass line. I didn't want to start with Black Market. We needed something to set up the bass line to Black Market. And that's when Doobie and I talked about the Juggler. And it's not even the beginning of the Juggler, dude. The phrase that we used actually came from the middle, and right. We used it as the intro to the drum solo. So really, that's where that came from. Wow. And worked out pretty well, I guess, huh?
It was a slap, man. Ta-da! It was like, in your face. Oh, eat man. This.
Yeah.
And Doobie, everybody hears your voice. How many times people have commented on different forums? What's that guy saying at the beginning of the drum solo? So what were you saying, Bob? Tell the world.
Nail this beast.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Nail this beast. And man, it was crazy. And tracking that thing was a pain in the butt. I could tell you that right now.
And we tracked the 16ths.
Wow.
That was the day I was happy I had chosen to play in the mallet.
I was even happier that I was able to sit in the air-conditioned car.
Yeah. So,
you guys later.
Yeah.
You know, what I find remarkable, too, is how so many people, you know, try to still, you know, or so many people did, like College Lines, try to play and learn that solo, you know, and actually do it, you know, verbatim. And it's become, you know, so legendary and so incredible. And the rototoms. And so I guess we should start to talk about how the line, right after we were talking about the Dream and how we lost to the Crossmen, and then as Jay was saying, we started to, you know, get our shit together, and you know, we made that little adjustment in the snare line to get us down to 8, and we were off and running, and the intensity level picked up. And then we started, you know, Santa Clara was badass that year too. And it became a tug of war. And then there was the night right towards the end, right before we went to Nationals, things were getting good. And it was Pittsfield, Massachusetts.
And Pittsfield, man, out in a baseball stadium.
It was a baseball stadium.
On a soggy, wet, misty night.
Horrible warm-up. Anybody want to recall the Matt, Mike?
I remember it was not good. And I remember, Doobie, do you remember this? You used to wear my watch. I used to give you my watch before we went on. Kind of as a good luck thing. Maybe I asked you to hold it one time. And then it just became tradition. And I remember giving you my watch and saying, and we had had a string of 19s.
That's right. Right?
Breaking,
yeah, 19. Like six or seven. Yeah, yeah, it was.
And I said, Doobie, do you think we're going to break a 19 tonight? He goes, we'll be lucky if we hit a 15 or something to that effect.
It sounded like mid-July warm-up. It was just like, what is going on? No matter what we tried everything. I mean, we were trying everything to get you guys to start playing, but it just seemed like everybody was just in a funk. Nobody wanted to be there. The weather was nasty. The stadium was terrible. I mean, I don't know what was in your heads, but it wasn't getting a 19, that's for sure.
I think all of the above. I think it was misty. The drums sounded like tubs because they were so moist, and it was just, you know, it was like that. And it was just not just one of those days. Just warm up was, I couldn't believe how we were walking down the field. We were late, actually, because we stayed in the warm up area so long. I can remember almost literally jogging out and going, this is unbelievable. I mean, it was just so bad.
Didn't somebody tell us, though, before we went on the field that Crossman had a three ticker? Did we hear that? I think that was a wake up call right there.
Yeah.
Could have been.
I don't remember how that happened or, you know, when, but it was like, what?
Well, you know, I can tell you without, you know, we're getting to the end before we talk about the show itself, but I will say that at the end of our performance, hanging out, and I was, you know, me and Robbie Robinson would hang out a lot and chat and, you know, always respectful. How'd you guys do? How are you guys doing? Because, you know, we were right there, right? He goes, yeah, man, we did a three tick. And he goes, how did you guys do? I said, I think it was one. And he says, no way. I said, maybe two, but rumor has it. He's like, oh, wow. Well, I don't know how that transpired. But Rob, if you're watching, you guys were badass. I can tell you that. But, you know, the show itself, I guess once we started, things definitely just clicked in and we started. I guess when the guy doesn't go to the pad after the opener, you know, and we, like Doobie said, we've seen that a few times. We were already, you know, played a bunch of low 19s, maybe a mid 19. But when he wasn't going to the pad, like at all, and things were, you know, amplified because of the humidity, maybe, I don't know. I started to hear things better, and it got clean really fast.
I remember being in the pit and we were up towards the front, and then there was about 150 yards and then the crowd. But in between the crowd and the pit was the staff. And at the end of the opener, he hadn't gone to the pad. And the staff is high-fiving and shaking hands. And at the end of the second tune, he didn't go to the pad. Now the staff is hugging, and I'm watching this. And then at the end, when the gun goes off, the staff was literally in a pile of people, you know, just all over each other. And I remember turning to Todd, because we had this one moment in New York, New York, where there was a da-da-da-da, and then there was a grand pause, and we would pop open sodas on the front from, we carried on our mallet instruments to just make the record, you know? So I looked at Todd, and we turned around, and I saw Pat and Mike and that side of the snare line, tears streaming down their faces, people screaming at the top of their lungs, you know, whooping and hooping and hollering and just going absolutely berserk on the field. It was an amazing moment. And those of you know my personal story is I had eaten eggs that day and was violently ill. And I was in the restroom, and I came out of the restroom and I said, Todd, I don't think I can make it tonight. And Todd says to me, yeah, but what if something special happens?
Wow.
Oh, wow. So I said, okay, I guess I'm going out there tonight, you know? So I went out, and of course, you know, and then afterwards, I think it was Matt Savage and Teofilo came over to me and said, okay, so listen, we're going to feed you eggs before.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I was not one of those staff members. I was so pissed off at the warm-up that I was sitting in the right field stands.
No way, really?
Yeah, I was way out there. I didn't even want to know anything, you know, because you suck. You're out of here. I mean,
we did, so, though. It was the most juxtaposition.
I was so angry. I've seen Jay Webb a couple times watching Avon do the same thing. He'll be standing on the track, and he'll hear something, and he'll do one of these at the kids, and then he'll just slowly walk off to the end zone.
So, Jay,
and he'll stand under the goalpost like this.
Jay, what was your recollection of the night as it unfolded, as the One Tick show unfolded from the tenor perspective?
Well, I just want to point out that the tick was not a tenor tick.
I understand that. I get it. I get that.
I don't remember a lot because I've been to Pittsburgh several times, and I have many up and down memories about it. I've been in that restroom, Jim. Terrible, terrible. But no, I just remember the staff being really intense. My best memories are at the school afterwards, where we were out back doing Forzando Uses, Crescendo Uses, and De Crescendo Uses. But that was a special night.
Yeah,
the one thing I remember, though, in general, that whole last 2 or 3 weeks, we could play the opener without a tick almost any time we wanted. It became like a test, like a challenge. I remember one time Doobie was like, all right, you knuckleheads, if you were going to run unless, you know, or something terrible, unless you could play the opener without a tick. All right, we can do that. But I remember being really nervous in the New York stuff, because there wasn't a lot of hard in there, but there was a lot of ticks to be made. A lot of opportunities to make a stupid blunder. And it was just like the nerves. It's like missing a layup at the last second. In an NCAA tournament. So
what's funny is, Dennis, you were talking about that too, is like, and we were talking about that when we talked on the phone, was that, you know, you had asked me, and maybe that'd be great to hear everybody's input, was that the best show ever that year? Mm-hmm. And like Jay just said, we played a few shows that under the current status would be called a perfect show. So that was a One Tick show in a 19-8. You know, we didn't max out in PA, I guess, right? I don't know why, but so a 19-8 in the tick system. But I think we played many shows that were pretty damn good like that, in rehearsals for sure.
I know that the last, I don't know, maybe 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks, the last three, I mean, to me, every rehearsal was magic. It was just, you guys were on a roll playing this show, and it was, as somebody, I'm sure Doobie feels the same, as the people that were putting the notes down on a piece of paper, to listen to it back at that level of not just cleanliness, but expressiveness, was just, I mean, you can't ask for anything more than that. It was just incredible, incredible. But, you know, going back to Pittsfield, of course, you know, can't sit, there's no place to sit as a staff member. So most of us were out laying on the ground, you know, and we're out of bounds, and I'm down on near the goal line, and we're just hanging out, and I'm watching the tick judge, and he didn't go to the pad. So I kind of felt like I was in basic training again, kind of crawled over to the 10, and then he doesn't go to the pad again. Oh, now I'm on the 20. You know, it was one of those things, just listening and watching this thing. It was wonderful.
Once we got to Montreal, you know, I can remember, Bob, you having a talk with us when we got out there, remember, about how we're going to not put the brakes on, but you're not going to really, like, rehearse and work us so hard. You wanted to maintain what we had and not overdo it and stuff like that, or something to that effect. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do. And it was a risk. I mean, when you're trying to figure out what to do with what you have, like, how much is too much? How much are we going to, you know, overkill this thing? You know, can we get it? So 1980, 27 Lancers. 1980 27 Lancers at Allentown was probably one of the best drum corps shows I ever witnessed. And that was it. They just slowly went down. No offense to any Lancers watching. Amazing drum corps, amazing drum line. But it's almost like they kind of peaked too soon. They were 1 week early. I think they would have won DCI if they would have put that performance on the field in 1980 in Birmingham. But they just seemed to lose a little momentum going into the last week. And I kept saying to myself, I don't want that to happen to this drum line. I don't want to just keep playing and playing. And, you know, I will trust the maturity of the line that when it's time to play, they're going to play. And, you know, Mark Purdom, I mean, you're such a quiet, unassuming guy. What was your whole take on all of that stuff that we just talked about? You know, the whole 19-8 night, the bad warm-up. I mean, what goes through a guy's head who's, you know, first year being involved with all these crazy people? And, you know, what were you thinking? Like, how did you feel about that whole thing?
Well, you know, a lot of it for me was, you know, the intensity was something that I had never experienced before, right? So for me to even be on that field with you guys was like, you know, just incredible experience. But I was so focused on things. I could not have told you that a judge didn't go to a pad. I could not have told you. I was focused on playing that book, you know, exactly what's happening right now, not the next note, not the note before it. Do you know what I mean? So it was just a super intense kind of thing. And you got off the field. I'm like, we did what? That's kind of cool. it's an amazing thing. But really for me, it was an experience where, you know, it taught me so much, because it taught me, you know, you can want something, but you got to really put in the effort. You got to really focus. You got to really, you know, put the intensity behind it. And that's what I learned. And that's, you know, it wasn't like, you know, Pat and the nucleus of that snare line that was there before me. I mean, maybe at that point they were locked in a little more than I was. I don't know. But at the same time, you know, it took a lot of focus. So I was more concentrated on the music, playing, doing what we were doing than like, oh, hey, we had a 19-8 show. But, you know, it's fantastic to look back on it.
Al, what do you think?
Oh, man, that Pittsfield show, what I remember a lot about that was the opening. The tap roll before the rim shot.
Yeah.
That tap roll was so rock solid. you didn't hear it, you felt it. And it just kept going from there. And it was almost like a blur. We just kept playing and playing and got better and better. And the expressiveness and us just being that tight and that close was ridiculous. I couldn't understand. And once we saw what's up, we had a one-tick show. That was wow. That's all I can say was wow.
That blur, that's it. You know, it was like a blur, that show. Yep.
You know,
and it was. It was great.
You know, Bob, when you, you know, getting now jumping back out to Montreal, when you took that calculated risk, you know, I don't know if you were aware of it. I think you may have been aware of it, but it caused a little bit of a rift in the core, because I know that the horn line was pissed, because we did a lot of polishing drums, you know,
well, and I know polished. They were black and gold. They were beautiful.
I know. Absolutely. And I do know that, you know, there was a little bit of like, where's the drum line hanging out again, you know? And you remember having to put out a couple of little fires, you know, with people, hey man, you know, listen, you know, he knows what he's doing, you know? But it was, I don't think we put the brakes on, but I think you did the right thing, to be honest. I really do. And it was chilly.
Yeah, it was cold.
It was chilly. It was, you know, it was chilly. And then there was prelims.
Yeah. And then I thought maybe I made a mistake.
Then you thought, well, what do you think? What do you think? What did you think?
I have my personal opinion about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think it would
be a good time to hear it.
I don't know if it would be a good time to hear it, because
God, I understand.
I don't think it had anything to do with us.
Got it.
I'll leave it at that.
So
I will say though, Pat, I remember prelims, and we were angry.
pissed.
We were a super angry group, and we probably were a little out of control emotionally and mentally. And that's a lesson I've learned from that. But I remember being on the bus, finding out that Santa Clara got an 8-0 in PA. Mm-hmm. And we were on 2 hours after them or something like that. And
dig that.
The anger that was going on and in that warm up. I don't know if it was that warm up, but there were some dudes from Troopers that were watching us warm up, and they were tapping their hand when we were doing that roll and shaft. And, you know, we were pulling it. And they would go, yeah, man, they're slowing that down. I remember I almost stepped out and ripped some kid's head off of the line. Because, you know, I was like,
people would do that. Yeah,
I know. But we were just so angry and out of control. At prelims, I never forget that, coming off the bus.
Yeah.
And then the rototoms fall over.
Well, what happened with that was it was windy as hell.
Yeah.
And I'm coming up to my rototom and I seen it fall. And I'm like, okay. And you're right, Joe. You're right, though, Jay. I think we had a chip on our shoulder. I think we overhyped.
We were yelling at guys.
I mean, not all of us, but some of us.
Yeah.
But yeah. And, yeah. But my rototom fell over as I'm coming up. Da-da-z, da-da-z, and there it goes. And I'm yelling, pick it up! Pick it up! And I'm yelling at the kid in the pit. I'm like, pick it up! And he's looking at me. It's like, I said, pick it up! Just in time, you know? And I'm playing. He's standing down there. It's a great picture of it, Jim. I'm sure you can find it. But he's kneeling down, and he's holding that rototom. Because it was the bigger one, and it just like the wind just like, and we had problems with that all year, you know, with the wind blowing stuff over. But I'm just screaming, pick it up, you know. But it was windy, and it was just, you know, it was maybe not our best, best run. What about Bronco? What you got in your memory banks?
Yeah, well, I remember in Montreal having a practice at that school. And Doobie would be the one that would work us all the time at practices and warm-ups. But at this one particular time, Dennis got in front of us. And he started laying us down doing the roll warm-ups we were doing. And he would get us down to that level one thing. And he would just, and he would put his hands, like, he'd even bring it down just a little bit more. And we were playing that so tight, so clean, that he just that's it. That was it. He said, guys, that's it. Take a break. It's awesome.
Yeah. I actually remember that, too. I remember him telling us to take a break.
Yes.
Yep. I remember it. Same thing.
Remember that.
Sorry, I'll say that again.
You thought we were so good, and you said, okay, play this. And then we did. You said, oh, shit. Okay.
It's true. But we were a line and an entity that taught by feel. And that's why, you know, somebody from another corps or whatever, it would slow down a roll just a little bit. But think about how hard it is to play a nine count roll, forte piano crescendo, clean as could be, with a slight retard and a rim shot at the end of it. Think of, that is so freaking hard to do. Mm. I mean, it's unbelievable. I was about 3 years ago, I guess, I was going to Allentown, and on the way up to the press box level, the guy who guarded the gate to get up to the upper deck is a former drum corps drummer. And he stopped me and he said, I got to tell you this story. He said, I went to Santa Clara's rehearsal this afternoon. And in the middle of the rehearsal, they had a long roll with a rim shot at the end of it. And Rennick did not like what they were doing at all. And he stopped the line and he said, your homework is to find the 82 Bridgman soundtrack and listen to the way it's supposed to be done. And
He said specifically, listen to the roll, long roll with the rim shot right before in Shaft. That's right. The rim shot heard around the world.
Right. Right. Yeah, it was great.
And on 15-inch drums, it's just like a cannon. So it's,
yeah.
It's a big difference. Yeah. So, you know, prelims was a rough one. We lost but then we get down to brass tacks and finals and we are trying to, harness all of that, things like, man, we've been doing so great. And all of a sudden we lost prelims, but the PA score, we realized. And then when we realized what the panel was, I think that was that eased our minds a little bit, but I can tell you that, and everybody can chime in, but Montreal, man, that stadium was a bitch to play in, man. Mm. Between the turf and the
echo.
Oh my gosh. Favorite. Not fun. You start second guessing yourself. Like, is that what I'm hearing, or is that the coming up from the turf? It was a different vibe than being outside.
Definitely. I don't know how anybody judged in there. Hmm.
That was a rough one. It was rough. Matt, I can remember starting the show, and I know, do you remember what you said right before the show started?
Oh, no, I don't.
No?
No.
We were, we started like this, right? And right when we're getting ready to start, and we can barely hear the count off of stuff, and he goes, you're real excited. He goes, okay, boys, here we go. I'll see you at the end. We'll see you later. we'll see you guys later. I was like, okay, Matt, see you later. it was hilarious. It was really funny. Yeah. The last one, guys, I'll see you later. See you at the end.
Right.
Yeah, it was great, though. It was cool. And but it was, I think it was a good show. I mean, it's kind of hard to tell. You listen to the record. In the recording, and you hear a lot of reverb and bouncing around, but it was a good show. It was good. It was different than the One Tick show, but I think it was still a great run. We needed it because Santa Clara was no joke that year. Great solos, great everything. They were phenomenal.
Yeah, they were.
Really, I remember great. Some of the competitive aspects of that because we were on so early. I think the team in ninth or tenth overall, so we were on like second or third.
Well, we were eighth. Eighth overall.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But the field judge Jimmy Mallon, he was. I remember he walked by us and he said, play the show. You got it. Hmm. And I think that gave us some confidence that the placement where we were as a core wasn't going to get in the way of our the drumline's performance.
Absolutely.
And it's too bad that we were so segmented, and that was a problem with that core as a whole. Now, as a director of a group, I would be like, "That we can't have that. You know, we can't have that dysfunction that we have."
In what way you were saying, like I was talking about between hornline drumline?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it was there, right?
Yeah, but I felt relieved that that we were going to get a fair shot, where it didn't seem like we got that in prelims. That's how I remember.
And I think we had, I guess, a 7 ticker. I think. Mm-hmm. It was a lot of ticks, and we were like, "Ooh, that's a lot." But then, as the night went on, and we start sawing it, you know, Jimmy did a great job mm-hmm. on his tolerance.
Yeah.
He did a phenomenal job. He did a great job.
He definitely did not change his tolerance at all. The whole, he was very consistent. And I do remember Jimmy would always talk to us. Jim, if you're watching, how you doing?
Yeah.
He would always talk to us and give us, you know, little pep talk and confidence, and give us a little wink mm-hmm. and hello, boys. Give us a little wink and off we go. And, you know, Dan, you know, coming, winning drums from eighth place had never been done before. Never.
No.
Don't know if it's ever been done again, but
it'll never
like
be
they
done
said.
No. Once.
Like, incredible feat.
Once ticks went away.
Yeah. You can't do that now.
No. If your horn line is in ninth place today, your drum line is going to be, if your drum line got to seventh on a subjective system, you would have a party. It's unfortunate. Shouldn't be that way, but it is.
Well, I mean, I, having been out of the, you know, activity for so long, and not, you guys have been going through all these changes, you know, with your cores and with your lines and with stuff, and it's such a thing. I'd love to hear what you guys would think about the subjectivity of the judging, how that would have affected us then as opposed to what it is now. I mean, you know, my opinion is we probably would have had a few perfect shows as opposed to, you know, one under this subjectivity. What are your thoughts?
Maybe you would have been more deserving of more shows. But the way it evolved by the late 80s, I don't know about that, Pat. I don't know if we would have gotten the call. Really don't know. Would have deserved the call, but I don't think would have gotten it.
Good way to put it.
Yeah, so that being in eighth place with the subjectivity, you don't think we would have transcended that, like, and still won drums. We may have been slotted, you're saying?
Jim and I were looking at some recaps this afternoon, and it's really amazing when you go across a whole recap and just follow the Bridgman line and, you know, visual 10th and 11th and brass 9th and 10th and effects 7th or 8th. And percussion first or second, that will never happen. Mm-hmm. Because, well, we remember how frustrated we were with Jim Campbell there, because when he would do a subjective caption, he would do a degree of excellence or content or effect. We never did well with him. But when he judged ticks, we did very well with him. Mm-hmm. But when he had to choose the number in the ranking, it was never what it should have been.
He went there, and there it is.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah. I mean, the activity changed.
It has really changed.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Jay.
Well, you know, I'm still out there judging some, and I've been judging now for almost 28 years, and it has changed so much. And Granada used to come and stay with me around DCI time when it was here. And we would get in these crazy, crazy things about how great Bridge in that time and feeling and the groove. And now it's, I don't know. And I'm like, dude, it's still great. And it is great. I mean, the kids, the level that they play at nowadays is,
yeah.
I mean, I have freshmen in my program that played my senior recital in college, for their lesson. So it is still great. It's just different. And I think, like what we're talking about is kind of like almost like an NFL team. And I remember the last couple of weeks of that season in 82, scoring a 19 had only happened four or five times in history of DCI. And we scored like eight or nine in a row. It's like Tom Brady throwing Super Bowl after Super Bowl after Super Bowl and winning those 19s. And you asked if that was our best show ever, the 19-8. I'm going to say CYO Nationals was the best show we ever played.
Wow.
I don't know if you guys remember that, but we used to play that role on the rim, intense,
in your face. Right.
And we were coming down the hill at CYO, and we were incredible that night. I thought that was the best show we ever played.
I remember the wall. The wall was, I don't know where that came from.
Birmingham,
you put us in front of a brick wall, and you said melt that wall is what you basically.
Yeah, I think it was almost like, you know, a wall. I wanted you guys to be just so focused, like Mark was talking about, just being focused on what you're doing. Don't worry about anything else. Don't worry about the rest of the core. Don't worry about, you know, all that stuff is going to fall into place. Don't worry about judges, who's judging, who's not judging. Just look, you got to be immovable. You got to be like this wall right here. You can't let anything. You could take anything you want and, you know, hammer it, beat it, punch it. It's not going to move. And you guys need to have that kind of mindset when you're playing. I think that was the gist of it. You know, you just got to, you can't let anything from the outside get in the inside. And just, you know, approach, just pretend that you're this wall. Just stare at that wall. No matter what you do to it, you're not going to penetrate it. You can't let anything penetrate you. And I think that and the man in the glass, you know, everybody contributes. Every single person, we're only as good as the, you know, the weakest player in the line, period. And if we don't get those guys on board, you know, we can have all the Pat Petrillo and the Matt Savage and the Jay Webb Insanity and the Mike Bronco and everybody else that's here. That's all well and good. But if we don't get Mark Purdom on board, no offense, Mark, but, you know, Mark was not part of that whole tradition. And we all realized that we got to reach those kids. We've got to reach those guys in order for us to get to the level that, you know we could, and we know we should. So
there was something else that Doobie said. I remember vividly like it was yesterday. And I want to say it was, we had played two or three 19s in a row, and you came to us and you said, what would you do if you were on Phantom staff? One night they have a 19-2, the next night they have a 16-9. What do you tell those kids? And I remember, you know, you saying to us, you guys all know what it feels like when you play a 19. Even if the guy doesn't, you remember how you felt, I think it was at the Lexington or something, like we played the first 19 that year. And I remember Doobie saying, yeah, you know what it feels like to play a 19. You know what it feels like. Because every time you do it, you know what that feeling is. And then I remember you saying, so why don't we try to find out what it feels like to play a 20? And why don't we rehearse like that? And those things, that message, I tell that story every year to my kids too. You have to rehearse like you want a perfect score. That's how you have to rehearse. And I remember that. And the next night it was Pittsfield.
So Jim's wow. And all this stuff, are you going to give me a check?
Yeah.
You got a copyright check.
I'm sure we've all used the lines before when we're teaching.
You know, and the other thing, Bob, is you would judge every final run through, and I'm sure, and I would love to see if you probably don't have any of those sheets, but there was many a time where we played three ticks. At least. I don't know if we ever got down to one or two. But plenty of run-throughs, and you knew where everything was, and you would run to each place. You and Pat would run to each place, right? Give it to me. Okay, give it to me, wherever it was, and you'd go, and you knew where it was. And that was our yard marker, basically. And you made sure that we were there to do that, you know, hit those parts.
Yes, it did. Hey, Bob, I remember one speech you gave us. It was the what if speech. What if God said, if you guys practice 5,000 hours, you will win a national championship, and you only practice 4,999 hours? So every minute of practice should be gold. Every chance we get to practice, let's do it. And we kind of stuck to that. And there was a lot of practicing going on. We played.
Yeah. Don't leave nothing. Don't leave nothing on the field.
No.
Can I share a story?
Yeah.
You done, Al?
Say it again?
Yeah, Al, you done?
Yeah, I'm done.
Can I share a story?
Yes.
The biggest thing about 82, I think, was the intensity that we all had through the season. And just the pressure that we put on ourselves to just to be great. And Mark, I don't know if you remember, but we were in Rockford, Illinois at the Phantom Regiment show. And after playing the show hundreds, if not thousands of times over and over again, you had a little bit of a block going on, and you had a hard trouble playing one certain part. I can't remember what it was. And you came to me, and I said, well, let's go work on it. So I took Mark off to the side, and we worked on that part. We basically broke it down from scratch to get it going again, and to give Mark that confidence to get going again, because it's just like everything was just so intense that all of a sudden he just had trouble doing that one thing, and it was an incredible thing, and he came through, and man, he finished the season out. It was just incredible.
It was, yeah. Yep.
I remember that night, Mike. I remember that night. I remember just, you know, I lost my concentration. Just, you know, it doesn't take long. You lose it in a book like that. You lose your concentration for, you know, a half a second, and it's gone. So, yeah, I really appreciated that help you gave me, and it brought it back. And I don't think there was an issue, you know, the rest of the year after that.
Nope, it wasn't.
So awesome.
You know, I will admit that I never played the six-stroke role in the charge of the opener in 1981. I never played that thing.
What? Now you tell us.
That's hilarious.
I had a block there. I couldn't do it for some reason. It happens.
You know, I got to say, with 82, the other thing was with the nucleus of us coming in, and you know, Matt can attest to this too. You know, there was no more, you know, Moon wasn't around anymore. The Mindyaks were gone. You know, Eddie Drayton decided not to march that year. So it was almost not a passing of the baton, but it was like, all right, you know, we got to step up and lead now. We have to be the nucleus. I mean, it's just a different vibe now. You know, 81 was almost like autopilot. No, this is a little different, because now, you know, it's on us. Collectively, Jay and everybody else now. I've totally felt that, especially when Dennis said, okay, you know, tap it off, brother. And I was like, okay, here we go. So that's the thing. All of a sudden, we're all in a different role, aren't we now? So I think that was a huge thing. At least, you know, I think we all kind of, it took us a while to rise to that occasion, maybe. First half of the year wasn't there, but then I think we did, so.
I think the 82 line, like I said way, way back, was a culmination of 80 and 81. And, you know, I was in a section with Edmund Mindyak, who was just always the same, just always solid. Wasn't the best player, but he was always solid. And when he wasn't there anymore and Donald was not there, and you felt that we had to carry on, like you said, it felt a responsibility to the past. The past two lines and the past people, Moon and all those guys, to carry
absolutely,
on.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it took us a while, I think, to get it together, but I think we did eventually.
When Dennis and I were talking earlier last week about this drum lesson we were going to have together with this Chinese student, we were talking about getting together, and I thought about this phrase that we were standing on the shoulders of giants, you know, the former Bridgman members before us, and trying to do them justice, because man, they were always watching. They literally, they were there, they were coming, they were checking us out, and I think we all felt we had to, you know, represent them, and we had expectations. Another thing about practice, I tell my students now, still to this day, some of the best memories I have of being in the Bridgeman weren't necessarily winning two drum trophies, but the practices were my favorite part of being in the line. The practices were just so intense. And when it was time to run back, you know, you work with groups and a couple kids maybe run back and everybody else is like, come on, man, we would finish a rep and everybody would in an instant turn, run, scream, yell, hype, and get back again to do it again. Just like Al said, you know, how many times can we get it in there? You know, how many times can we play it perfect to make sure it's consistent? So the practice was my favorite part of Bridgeman. It was a magical kind of like aligning of stars, you know, to have those people then.
We didn't have far to run though.
Yeah, we did.
Three steps, I'm there.
Yeah, I would go through the drill, and Doobie would say, he go over to Mac or someone. I think it was Mac, and really, you got to get from here to here, and how many steps? We got to fix it. We got to change that. We got to shorten that up a little bit. Let's turn that into a bigger phrase. Let's take our time getting from point A to point B.
Like a snail. Boy.
And then right, so after this, then Dennis, you know, we ended up, you know, winning in 82, the third one. And then you, at the end of the season, I don't know when you found out, but you got a call that was from the PAS people, and it was pretty special. So what happened then?
PAS actually books their clinics and their artists much earlier than that. So, I mean, I knew for months that the only question was, can we get everybody there? Does the organization, because I didn't run the organization, does the organization want us to go? Do we have to bring our drums? How are we going to do this? And Silingaling came through. They made a brand new set of drums for us. We just had to bring sticks, mallets, and, you know, some things and some toys and stuff, and borrowed a lot of stuff in Dallas. And
so this was the PAS convention in Dallas, Texas, in November of 1982,
right.
Which was shortly 3 months after DCI finals. And it was the first time that a drum line performed, I believe, a drum corps drum line. One of the first. I heard that the Anaheim Kingsmen did it many years before that or something like that. But a known DCI drum line to do PASIC, basically.
Yeah, it was definitely the first time that a drum corps drum line had been given a feature spot. Don't forget, we were on at 4 o'clock Saturday afternoon, which is like the gold marquee, you know? And I've never been more nervous getting ready to do a clinic as I was that day, because I'm looking backstage and I'm looking out in the audience, and here's Steve Gadd and here's Ed Shaughnessy. And, you know, it's like, wait a minute. Okay, what are we doing here? You know, it was amazing. And of course, the first rehearsal down in Dallas sucked. And I'm going, oh my God, what did we get into here? But by Saturday afternoon, man, you guys played your ass off. It was
good. Yeah, I don't know if Bob remembers, if he can chime in on those, but there was definitely a bit of a, how does that go again? And, you know, they flew us in from wherever we were, different places and what have you, to get there. And it was fun and stuff, and get the drums and tune them up. And Slingeland had them all out on the floor. We had to go in there and pick them up and tune them up. But yeah, it was one of those kind of things, I think. Right, Bob?
Yeah, it was just a lot of fun, I think. I mean, we kind of knew going in that we weren't going to be what we were in August. That would be impossible, because we didn't rehearse in Bayonne at all, right? We just met in Texas.
We did one rehearsal in Bayonne. I remember that.
Right.
The problem is right. Probably people missing though.
Yeah, I wasn't there. I was
probably not everybody there.
Yeah.
So we all gather in Dallas and like we have 2 days to get this together and I think Dennis and I both thought, you know, it'll take a little time to get them rolling, but once they recall and get everything back in their heads, the maturity of the group is going to be able to represent.
Well, with so much talent and at that point, so much experience in the line, it was only a question of, will it take 3 days or 4 days, which we don't have, or two, you know, what's it going to take? But I knew it would happen, just didn't know if it happened in time.
The first night was rough for sure.
Tough.
And we have people out there watching us a lot, you know, and finding a place to practice was a thing too.
Yes.
That was a thing.
Yeah.
You know. Where are we going to, be right in front of the hotel. We had to go there and it was kind of bouncing around and stuff, but it ended up being great. And it was just a very memorable moment for sure. And it all came together great. And Bob played amazing timpani. It was great.
We still have the footage.
We have the footage that's on YouTube. And I think, as a matter of fact, Jim Miller, this would be a good time to go to the video.
Go here. Wasn't that cool?
Wow. That was badass. And Matt Savage doing his 16th note thing, demonstrating the finger thumb. That was awesome.
I love this guy's name for snare drum. This is it. This is the best name. Matt Savage. All right, so here's how we developed this left hand technique. We did it just with one tap, eighth note. Faster and faster. We have a couple of guys in the line that can do this at about 132, play 16th notes with the left hand, write a term paper at the same time with the right hand. You know, it's unbelievable.
Yeah.
individual solo.
Played my solo, yeah. And yep. This was the drum I played it on, as a matter of fact.
Okay, there's a facet of marching percussion that the general public very rarely gets to see, if at all. It seems to be confined to a relatively small group of fanatics who go to the DCI National Championships and somehow manage to sit through the two-day-long individual and ensemble event. We have a snare drummer who entered the individual competition this year and came in second out of about, I don't know, 30 or 40 contestants. And I went to his performance, and I would like to meet the person who beat him. I mean, he was just that incredible. And this is a composition that he put together himself. We believe that anybody who's going to get involved in the individual or ensemble portion of DCI activity should write and prepare their own piece. We did not prepare this for him. So I'd like you to meet our section leader, his name is Pat Petrillo.
And, you know, we were just like just excited. I mean, just seeing the whole thing was my first PASIC ever, and just I'm sure all of us would, you know, first PASIC ever pretty much. And
it changed my life. I had never seen anything like that. I had not gone to college for percussion like most everybody else. I was a drum corps kid too, from Florida. And when I saw that, I was like, oh my God, I couldn't believe it. The other thing is they had, Ward had set up that first indoor drumline competition.
That's
it was
right.
One of the first ones. And I remember watching that and going, that's so cool. I could do that at my high school. And I remember after PASIC at the Christmas concert, we did a little thing at Jonathan Dayton Regional High School that I was teaching at. So I just, that going to PASIC changed my life and made me pursue going into music and becoming a music major and ultimately a band.
That's very cool.
That's awesome.
Very cool.
Yeah. I would probably not have done that.
And you have had an amazing career, Jay. Really. Yeah. I mean, seriously.
Unbelievable.
Just amazing.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Really fantastic.
But by the way, can we go just go around? Just tell me very briefly what you're all doing now. Jim, I know what you do, but why don't you make sure that the guys know?
Sure. I've been the director of music at Bunnell High School in Stratford, Connecticut. Now this is year 35 after doing 3 years in Kinnelon. I've been here all this time, and I've had the absolute honor of working with Dennis on our staff between the fall marching band and the indoor drum line. Now, gosh, I think we're going on 20 years teaming up here, and it's been amazing.
Mark, what are you doing?
I work at Raymond James, the stock brokerage, and I design stock trading systems and, you know, option trading, stock trading, that kind of stuff. So
I have an account at Raymond James, so we need to talk. Doobie retired. I can't. How is that going?
Oh. Doobie's retired. Well, actually, I got a call in the fall. Apparently, Indiana University had so many student teachers that couldn't student teach in the fall because of the COVID. So they all moved to the spring. They had 28 student teachers and they only had two supervisors. So they contacted myself and Janice Stockhouse, who's a band director at Bloomington North. We both retired at the same time. So I'm currently a university supervisor for four student teachers from IU. So that's been kind of cool. Unfortunately, have to do it over the Zoom stuff, but
yeah.
It's been good. And I'm still doing some indoor judging, and I judged one IPA live this year. It was wonderful to be in the gym and see all those kids. And they did a wonderful job keeping everybody safe the way they organized it. I don't think, Jay, the season went without a problem, right? I mean, I didn't hear anything.
It did.
Yeah. Amazing.
It really did. We had all our shows.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. That's great. That's cool, Doobie. I didn't know you were doing that, but that's a perfect role for you, you know?
Yeah, I'm not going to do it anymore after this.
Okay. Good decision.
Too much paperwork. It's just the paperwork is that, and Jay, you know, the if you have a student teacher, they have a structured observation that has nothing to do with music. We're evaluating.
Or teaching.
We're evaluating these kids on a rubric that makes no sense for a music teacher. And if anybody's watching from IU, good. I'm glad you're hearing me say it for the 15,000th time, because I said it when I was a teacher, that you got to get rid of that thing and get something music related so that these kids have a better chance of passing. Mm. There you go.
And learning.
And learning.
Todd, what are you up to?
Oh, so I'm in Northern California working as an engineer in Silicon Valley. I'm not doing any marching percussion at all, but I do have R&B and funk band that we play all the good old stuff from back in the day when we were on the bus, you know, Cool and Dandy, Earth, Wind, and Fire, and so on. So that's what I do.
You playing drum set there?
Keyboards, actually. Fender Rhodes.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That's great.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. Matt?
I wear many different hats. Not one special thing. I say to some students, I'm a drummer. I don't have a real job. I teach lessons over Zoom in the last year. Before that, I was doing a ton of judging, which I miss a lot. I do a lot of drum circle facilitation for team building, for leadership, for musicians. What else? Clinics, you name it. Write, teach, a couple high schools in the area.
You've never seen one of Matt's drum circle events, I mean, he is the best at it because he's got the perfect demeanor to talk to people that have never touched a drum in their life and people that are quite accomplished and make something work. And it's just great. Your drum circle stuff is the best.
Thank you, Dennis.
Awesome. Oh, and I have a summer marching percussion camp, too, that I should plug. It's going to be June 14th through the 18th. This will be the second year doing it virtually. And MattSavageDrumCamp.com. You have students that are interested.
Just saw an ad. Where'd
Facebook. Post something? Facebook, Instagram.
Yeah. Yeah. Jay, we know what you've been doing. Are you you retired but then went back? What happened?
I threatened to retire until they paid me way more money. we had made some changes, and so I'm still there for a little bit. I probably another year or two, I don't know. I do some judging for DCI bands, I do consulting and write for some bands too. So it's been in it forever, I guess. I don't know what else to do. I don't know how to do anything else.
Well, your track record is unbelievable. Unbelievable. Pat, is that, where are you? Is that your new studio?
This is my studio. Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah. You know, we got a little bit of this going on over here. And we got a little bit of that. And we got a little bit of this. So it's, I'm just doing lessons. I'm doing virtual. I do videos. I do a lot of drumeo stuff. My NYC Big Rhythm Band record was out. We did it at Abbey Road. That was just a dream come true, man, and I just, we're working on the next one. We're going to record at the power station in sometime in probably the late fall, October, November. And I've just been drumming, teaching clinics and doing what I can, and I was always, I have to say, one of my first gigs that I did, when I got out of college, after drum corps was a chorus line on Broadway. And having seen the Bridgemen do that in 76 left such a big impression on me. To actually be in the pit to play that show was one of those moments, So,
and of course, the highlight of your career was playing with Al Chez's band at my daughter Chelsea's wedding, right? Absolutely. I mean, that's it, right?
Anytime.
Doesn't get better than that. Yeah,
absolutely. That was a blast. It was a lot of fun.
Incredible.
Yeah. It was a lot of fun gigging, playing, teaching, and doing everything, but always having that, doing it with that Bridgman intensity and focus and everything that I learned from you and Bob and everybody, just
it's great.
Stick to it,
It's great. Al, I'm so proud. I'm so proud of you. that might sound a little condescending, and I don't mean it at all. I mean, when I heard that you had become a policeman in New York City and then a detective, I mean, I was so happy for you, so proud of you. I mean, so now retired?
Yes. After 30, well, my final position was, I was lieutenant for a schools division.
Really?
Yes, so I was a lieutenant for 15 years.
Wow.
And it's rewarding, rough, strange, exciting, something different every single day.
I bet.
From 7 in the morning until sometimes 4 in the morning. But it was great.
Wow.
I'm here to talk about it.
That's awesome, Al. Fantastic.
Amen. Amen.
I want to love on Al a little bit more, too. I tell people there are different types of players. There are solo players, and then there are line players, people who you have to be able to play with other people and play in a line. And I use Al as the epitome of the most amazing line player I've ever witnessed. Al, you like never ticked. You were always right in there. And it was such a pleasure to play next to you. And yeah, for taking me in as a little 1981 new guy.
Yes.
You're awesome.
It was great.
Al was always the silent assassin and the silent leader.
Yeah.
And I always admired that too. And it was just a mutual respect that we had, amongst everybody, of course. But, whenever there was something, you would make yourself known and heard and bring things up, and it was always on point, and it was always probably what needed to be done. And it was just always just a blast, you know, playing with you, and, you know, so much fun. Yeah, Dennis, you know, I think I speak for everybody to say we thank you for everything that you did for all of us in terms of, especially for this year, with the amazing solo that you wrote that became really a legendary solo that everybody in the drum core world knows and admires and loves. And thank you and Bob for everything you did for us.
Absolutely.
As individuals and as musicians in creating that amazing show that 1982 was, and we can't thank you enough, and thanks for everything.
Yeah, I appreciate it too. I just want to tell you that, and I mean, for me, I mean, God's got to get the glory for me, because I mean, I don't know why I'm wired the way I'm wired. I don't know why I think the way I think. I don't know why I came up with putting the snares in between the tenors and the basses. And then remember all those different sets we did and all these different motivational things. And I just gotta give God the glory, because I don't think I could ever come up with any of that stuff by myself, what I'm saying.
But thank you. You killed it, and you made us what we are.
When you go to bed tonight, say, thank you, God, for making Doobie what you made him.
Well, we want to thank everybody for watching this special event that we had here for the 1982 legendary Bridgman Drumline. So give everybody around here a follow, and we'll be putting some more stuff up for the next one, which will be for the other lines as well. So thanks, Dennis, Bob Dubinsky, everybody from the 82 line that joined us in this great meeting. And
a lot of fun.
See you guys.
Thanks, Jim.
All right, later.
Thank you, everyone. Love you.
Thanks. See you, Jim.
All right, love you guys, man. All right,
see you later,
everybody.
Take care.
Yep. Take care, fellas.